He's very motivated.
He is unsigned. Don't care.
He's kind of an enigma, but once he lets you in, you're in for life.
He is the leader of the Gary J Movement.
He's my brother.
He's the number one contender, the stiff Robo Ginger.
This is legit, like, it's weird, like, what do you do before you do it?
I legit just roam and walk around and, like, I guess it's me staying loose, if that makes any sense.
Throughout my short time of knowing Gary, he's helped me tremendously, whether it be wrestling or car rides or even, like, just passing through with each other. He always has some sort of advice for me.
Comes in, he likes to work with the young guys, teach them. And it's pretty neat. So he's always worried about everybody else, not himself, so.
I'm very honest, and I try to be very honest, and I actually really like helping people in wrestling. If they show they're very interested and passionate, and they're like, hey, I live right down the road, or I live a couple minutes away, can we get in the car together? Can I go to these shows with you? Can I try to get on these shows? Fuck yeah, let's go, because I never had that. I feel a lot of people get their training, and it's like, okay, but they don't know how to do business, they don't know etiquette. I like helping.
With Analog's work with him, like Analog's blowing up since then.
He's had a big influence on my wrestling style, I would say. Like, the Victor that you see in the ring is not like the same guy that he was before he met Gary J.
I lost again. On the last episode of 01 USA, I said I would end this losing streak, and I lost again.
I had a losing streak going on, and if I couldn't beat somebody, because I was at the 1 year mark without a win, then I would leave. Then Gary J stepped up, and I challenged him.
Give me a fight with Gary J.
Victor, I have a lot of respect for you. I see something that I don't see in many guys. That's that gleam, that's that sparkle in your eye. You wanna challenge me to a one-on-one fight, October 24th at 01? Because you're on a losing streak? I accept your challenge, Victor.
Nigga, new breed, loose cannon. Since a nigga learned a two-step, nobody wanna see me rain. Y'all know how the truth get. Whole squad dance off the squad.
Victor Analog's just fighting for his life right now, Ross.
Beat the shit out of a dead horse, boy. Stray dog running up the score, and we ain't even playing horse.
Then, you know, I beat him.
Wait a minute. I knew it. There was never a doubt in my mind. Victor Analog, the winner.
That match that gave me this fancy scar up here. I'd say that changed me in a lot of ways, other than like on the surface level with the scar.
How's it going for you?
Yeah. All right, I'm excited for what I'm doing tonight. In what world does Gary J live in where he's in the same match for Super Crazy kind of thing? You know what I mean? Like that, never thought that would be a thing.
Never thought in my life, in 2021, Gary J and Super Crazy in the same ring at the same time. ECW Mark, going wild.
Yeah.
Well, woo, how am I feeling? How you doing? I'm feeling. Every ache, every pain, it's worth it. Win, lose, or draw. The fact that I can go out there time and time again, and I know it sounds like a promo, but it's coming from my heart. It's right there. Not my brain, but I use my brain sometimes. At the end of the day, this sounds very K5 killer. It's a team, teamwork. Teamwork out there, teamwork back here. If I can go out there and produce with fucking super crazy in 2021, you too, Victor. But like, that's what matters. The people that paid, have fun, beer, boo, cheer, whatever, it's fun. I feel great, I'm a little tired, sus bus, all the good things, but this is gonna be a fun little journey with the cameraman and myself.
I think my biggest takeaway from Gary is probably to do what makes me happy and not really, can I cuss on here?
Yeah, go ahead.
Not really give a shit about anyone else.
Cool. Do you consider yourself a locker room leader?
Yeah, and it's not even because I want to be. It's like, I've been in the game since 2003. I'm tough. No, I'm just very stubborn and like, after a while, it's like, obviously, yeah, I've never been signed by a major company. I've never had a major company put me on TV. It's true. But I've been 19 years consistently hitting the pavement, doing the grind stuff, as the cliche shit says. But like, and I've worked, because you asked me earlier, is like super crazy, like one of the biggest people you've worked. And I was like, yeah, from ECW, but I have a laundry list of people I've been in the ring with. Sammy Callahan, Davey Richards, Kyle O'Reilly, Roger Strong. Kyle and David Richards actually molded me a lot early years in St. Louis. They were a big, big part of the St. Louis scene, especially St. Louis Anarchy. So they kind of helped make me what I am today with like the aggressiveness and like the way I move in there. A lot of that is like me learning from them and just taking what they taught me and kind of making it my own. But the, like I said, tangent, you asked me the locker room leader thing. You've kind of been following me around all day and like, what's weird is like, I guess, yeah, it's like, this goofy 34-year-old in charge of something, which is kind of weird. It's very humbling, very, very humbling, because I'm just still a kid that is out there, like, doing what he loves. Since day one, I didn't know what wrestling was in 2003. I just watched it. Gary the Barn Owl, Gary the Night Owl, Gary J, like, you watch me evolve from 2003 to now, and it's just like, oh, that's the same guy. I've even put on a little size, brother, you know, but like, and then if you're in the game so long, you build up this backstage street cred, as I like to say, or like people go, you're a credible guy. You show up, you do your job, you go home. In the landscape nowadays, that's very, very hard for people to do. They have to get in some kind of bullshit sussery. But like, yeah, to answer the question, after all that tangent, yeah, I do consider myself a locker room leader. I think people need more guys like me. And like Eric Cannon is another example of like a great locker room leader, a guy that's been everywhere, fought everywhere, been over different countries, wrestled the best in the world, and he's still in the indies doing his thing because he loves it and he wants to help the next generation not fuck up like we did so we can all just have good shows, make money, and go to the next town, you know? So like wrestling needs more people with like morals. And like, can just go, yeah, that's fucked up. I'm not gonna stand for that. Let's have a conversation as adults. And if that conversation means, all right, pal, you're out of here. I'm sorry, but you can't be doing that shit. This is a business. professional wrestling, you know what I mean? So, at the end of the day, yeah, I guess you could look at me as locker room leader. Silently, like I don't walk in a room and go, I'm the locker room leader. People come to me, ask me to watch their matches. Because a lot of these kids nowadays have been wrestling 5 to 7 years, and you gotta figure, I still trump them on years and like experience by a lot. So it's just insane. So my job is to get people over out in the ring, have quality matches, and help out anywhere I can backstage if need be.
There comes a point where you have to choose between this and marriage. And for the normal person watching this, or when they think about that, they would think, well, that's insane. Like, you would always pick marriage over this. But the normal person don't understand this. Like, they don't understand having a passion for something like pro wrestling, like Gary does, that you are willing to sacrifice real life things. Not, oh, I'm gonna not do my laundry today because I have to go wrestle. You're sacrificing things that you care deeply about to pursue this. And it's, those aren't easy choices. But people who want to succeed in this a lot of times have to make those choices. Not everybody does, but he's had to, and that's just the reality of what it is.
This is what professional wrestlers on the indies get paid with haircuts.
I'm Brittany Shaffrin, and I am Gary's ex-wife.
I've been doing this for 16 years. I can tell you right now, you are not doing shit with your beard.
I guess let's start from the beginning. How'd you and Gary meet?
On the internet. No, we both had plenty of fish accounts. I think we talked for a week or so, maybe. No, actually, we talked for on and off for like a month or two, and then actually pulled the trigger and went and met for drinks, and it was kind of like instantaneous. I was a wrestling fan prior. I've watched it all my life. Stone Cold is the man. But when, you know, we had our first date and we were kind of introducing, you know, ourselves to each other, and you know, he told me he wrestled, and I kind of laughed at him because I'm like, what? And so I think he was a little bit offended, but then he started telling me a little bit more about it, and so I'm like, oh, I'm like, I totally get this subject. And so it was really easy to understand, you know, with him being out of town and, you know, only being able to see each other here and there. It was kind of easy at the time, but we were also in our mid-20s, so we were, you know, living our own lives. But coming into it, it was pretty cool. He wouldn't let me see him wrestle for a while at first. I don't know if he thought I was going to make fun of him or, you know, if he had, like, any kind of insecurity issue. But when I finally did get to see him wrestle, he wrestled for an hour with Davey Vega, and it was the coolest match I ever saw. We got married New Year's Eve 2016. It was a little more difficult after we were married, you know, becoming a married couple, obviously the commitment level goes up a little bit. You know, it was a little harder then because he was working really hard and he was gone a lot.
That was when a lot of my like early years of like not dealing with emotion and being a fucking straight like stone wall of emotion and not dealing with it and just running away to travel and wrestle, it all caught up with me. She suffered because of that, and she had other stuff going on, and like she had to deal with it, and we just butted heads.
You know, it did get harder. You know, there were some aspects where, you know, we wanted to try and start a family, and, you know, mutual goals between the two of us that seemed to be a little harder to reach, just because of his hectic work schedule.
My schedule shift for my work was like 6 to 2 or 3. I got a code and key to the building. I would go to my warehouse job at like fucking 2 in the morning. I wouldn't sleep until like 11:30, 12 at night. That's like 2-3 hours of sleep if I'm lucky. I'd go to work, be miserable, work till 11:30, come home, sleep, and not talk to anybody. At the time, married to Brittany, I wouldn't fucking deal with shit because I was done. I was mentally and emotionally and physically exhausted. On top of the fact that, like, Gary J was still out there and fucking doing what I'm doing.
I think the best way to explain it for me is, like, when you co-parent a person and you live in two different households, it was like by the time Gary got home and came back to me, it would take 2 or 3 days to unwind his brain to get him to focus back on our marriage and the things that we were doing and, you know, just planning things, because it's like our life at home never stopped, whether he was there or not. So, you know, if he was gone 4 or 5, 6 days in a row, you know, I was there taking care of our household. So when he got home, I'm like, okay, now it's time to catch up. We've got things to take care of and do. And it took a couple days to actually get him to mentally unwind from that. Like, he, when he rides those highs, it takes a while to get him back down. And once I would finally get him there, then we were kind of to Gary Neller now at this point. It was hard for him to stay focused in this level, like, of just normal, regular life, because then all he was thinking about was wrestling. So it was really hard to get him to focus. It was really hard to get him to find passion in other things that mattered.
That all just broke me down. And then I couldn't deal with my personal life because I knew it was going to shit, but I didn't know how to handle it because I'd never been taught how to handle it, or I'd never been told it's okay to cry and have emotion. I was like, nope, I'm a robot, you know?
It was always wrestling. It was either unwinding his mind to get back to reality, or him being in reality and just wishing he wasn't. And so yeah, I think that's where it really took a huge toll on me, because whereas I love the wrestling side and I loved him being the man, I also kind of resented it a little bit because, you know, I wanted him to be the man at home too. I think it was it was close to the time to where, you know, I kind of switched gears a little bit, and I was getting a little older and I wanted to have a family. And whereas there was a level of an agreeance there, there wasn't the time or the effort for it. And, you know, I think then I really knew that he didn't really want to be a dad. You know, he didn't really have a lot of feelings towards that. And, you know, so I held a lot of resentment, and it kind of made me feel a little stuck. It's like, well, what am I doing here? You know, because, like, clearly at that point, we just weren't on the same page anymore. And, you know, he was always going to do what made him the happiest, which was wrestling. And it kind of just made me feel a little bit left out. And, you know, so I just went on my own way. You know, we had, it was really dark times there for a little bit, for him and for me, for separate reasons. And, you know, I kind of figured that I was kind of done sacrificing my own happiness, you know, and it was time for me to move on.
She's like, yeah, like, there was times where it was bad enough where, like, I was worried I'd get home from work and, like, you were going to be dead because you were so, like, fucking mentally strung out. And then she said that to me once, and I'm like, wow, that's really deep to think that, like, you're that fucked up when someone sees you that fucked up. But, like, I didn't think you were going to make it. You were, like, at that point of, like, I don't think he cares anymore about anything. And obviously, like, wrestling had a really big impact on that, because I was still going out there and I was still doing my job, because that is my job. That's what I love to do. It's my passion. But, like, then my personal life was just a wreck. And I didn't realize there could be a good balance of, like, doing good. Gary J's doing good. Gary Neller's doing good. It was Gary J's fucking at the top of the world. And then I'd come home. It'd take me a while to get back to, like, acclimate to reality. And then realize that, oh, I have these problems. I'm just going to, in, like, layman's terms, I'm just going to hide under these covers, you know? I'm just going to hide. Oh, I got to get back on the road. Got to go. That's not the answer. You run from your problems, they're going to catch up.
The only thing that really even saved us, even to get to this point, was we sat down one night, you know, after we had split up, you know, and it was a really emotional, finally a very good conversation that we could, you know, put the whole thing to bed. And, you know, we just promised each other that no matter what happened, that we would always remain friends, because that's how we started, and that's where we were at our best. And that's where it ended.
Wrestling's full of so many people, but if you have a couple tight bonds, that's all you need. You can be associates, and you can be cool with people, but, like, you have your tight bonds, you're paid to do your job and go home.
Who is Gary Neller?
Gary Neller is an incredible person. He's fiercely loyal. He's super intense inside the ring, outside the ring. He'll be fiercely loyal to you. He's got your back at all times. Him and I both have an understanding that if I need something, he's the first person I call. If he needs something, I'm the first person he calls.
I mean, there's not a whole lot of a difference between Gary J, the wrestler, and then Gary Neller, the human being, except Gary J is louder. And there was probably no difference in the two when we were younger, because even Gary Neller was very loud. So now there's definitely a difference when you've been doing this for so many years and your body's getting beat up all the time and you're traveling all the time, you know, and you get older, you become more mature, you know, I guess you calm down a little bit. And so he's calmed down from what he was, you know, back when we were kids, but not a whole lot of difference, really.
He's been doing it a while, so I may not have seen it as much as people have known him a lot longer, but I have noticed he's a little more calm. I don't really know how to put it into words, but like you can just see like in his eyes that like wrestling's taking a toll on him. He's willing to do more crazy stuff, I think, because he's wrestled so long, and he's like a cat. You can throw him off a roof and land on his feet, but as time goes on, that takes a toll on him.
There was a time the first marriage where he didn't care about his body. Like if you think these crazy bumps now are bad, these were even worse.
I would just physically try to harm myself in the ring because I didn't give a fuck in the world about what I was going through. Because I was like, this is entertaining. I'm just gonna try hurting myself because I don't care about my own free will or what's going on. There's a difference between that and doing something that works for the story or works for what you're doing in the ring. That was all for the wrong reasons at the time.
Like, if I break my arm or my neck, I don't care. Though, and there was a time when he was doing those things because he didn't care what happened to him. And then we had to have a conversation. And I could see that because, again, I've known him 20 years. You know, fans can't see that and wouldn't understand it. But I could see it and I could tell it was happening. And, you know, you have a conversation and, you know, you hope that you get through. And, it was tough. It's difficult to watch anyone go through that. But, you know, we almost had to move Gary out of his apartment before he went to Florida because he was going to get thrown out of it. I got evicted. Like, those are the real life things that fans don't see, that a lot of people don't understand. That's what this entails sometimes. Again, not for everybody, but that's what I really hope that people understand that Gary's went through for this. Not just falling down and getting back up in the ring, but, you know, two marriages, almost losing your apartment, and then going, well, okay, so we'll come move your stuff out, we'll put it in storage, and then we'll get in the car and go 16 hours to wherever the hell Florida we were going because we have shows. And that's the things he's done for this. And yeah, I mean, it's difficult to see anyone go through that, obviously.
I got therapy. I learned, like, therapy fucking saved my life. And I will say that 100 times over. Like, Sean Orleans gave me the therapy information. It was cheap, effective, and it was right down the road. And then enough people were like, you need to do it. I'm like, yeah, it's time. I need to let this shit out and, like, healthy and safe, not go bury my fucking emotions under booze and drinking for fucking the whole summer, which was a thing, and it wasn't good. But yeah, so that's the effect that, like, my personal life went through during those dark times. But like, I tried to never show that in character, but you could tell if you knew me, because I would just do this outlining of shit in the ring. And like, obviously I still do crazy shit in the ring, but now I've learned, like, now it's more for like story or like to add to something, or now build and or make somebody or make a moment that people might not remember anything on the show, but they'll remember that moment or that situation of like, whoa, that like fucking blew my mind. Because we all love wrestling because of like the theatrical storytelling that it can be. And if you use some of those big dumb bumps or spots in some of those storytellings, you're gonna remember forever, or you're gonna make someone's day, you know? Just because I'm having a bad day, I want to make your day great. And that's kind of how I like live now. I feel at the end of the day, like, Gary J now has kind of a name value of like, that's our dude. That, like, that's our fucking guy. That, like,
how you feeling?
Anxious, nervous, excited, all
balled up.
Feeling good though, but it's been a long day. Seems like it's paid off though, so.
Words really can't describe it, but Gary is probably like one of the most important people, not only to like Midwest Wrestling, but to St. Louis Anarchy, because he's done it all. Like, he's literally done it all. He's a hidden gem. He definitely deserves to be on more people's radars. I think that he's one of the most talented people I have ever met. The wealth of knowledge that he has is, it's just vast. It's insane. But he's probably one of like the most important people and probably one of the best people that I've met.
You know, we run in an area that's very oversaturated with promotions. There's like 14 different promotions where we run. So there are guys who choose to wrestle elsewhere, which is fine, and there are people who just work for Anarchy, and Gary's one of those guys that just works for Anarchy. And to the fan base, that, I mean, that makes it a bigger deal, right? Like, so you can only see him in one particular place.
Request, this match is under traditional ROH pure wrestling rules.
Some people might say that he's a stepping stone, but he's not a stepping stone. He's one of the four pillars of St. Louis wrestling in its whole. You just know that if your name's next to Gary, you're in for a rough night. Like, I mean, like a good way. He's an intense guy, and you just know you're in for it whenever you're around Gary or whenever you're in a match with Gary, because he just takes wrestling just that seriously. That's really just kind of probably the only thing that he really has at the end of the day is wrestling.
He has that spirit and the drive, and he feeds off of the crowd, and you feel it through him. Every time he makes a dive, every time he does a crazy bump, it's like you feel like you just went through it.
Everybody that does this profession, you know, whoever it is, whoever falls down for a living, obviously puts their body on the line, but Gary goes above and beyond that. And that's not just an Anarchy, it's everywhere, but to our fan base and in our like world, that's what the fans see. Like, they've seen Gary thrown from the ring over three rows of chairs into a brick wall. They've seen Gary UFO'd into the crowd in front of on no chair to splat off the ground. Like, they've seen that, and they've seen it for 10 years that we've been running. So fans nowadays are smart enough to know, like, that shit hurts. Like, it's not, you know, you feel that the next day and for the next week, and that helps him too. Because you have to care about what you're doing to do that, and you have to probably care more than the average person does about it to do that.
Referee Aaron Grutter has informed me that we have reached the 60-minute time. The result of this contest is a draw, meaning that still champion, the Monarch, Jeremy Ryan. One more time for the stiff robo ginger, Gary fucking Chad, 60 goddamn minutes of war.
He's the face of St. Louis Anarchy, whether he's the champion or not. Like, if you think St. Louis Anarchy, you're thinking, you know, the stiff robo ginger, Gary J. That's who you're thinking of.
I recently read a whole book. Don't tell anybody. No, but like, I don't know. Pandemic really changed my way of thinking, because I used to get sad, depressed, and like I'm just staying inside, which was the worst mentally thing for me. So a pandemic happens, everything's shut down. It's like, well, the only thing I can control is myself. Obviously my habits get better, my brain was a little weird, but like, I started really coming outside and realizing I'm like a hippie. That minus the smoking pot thing and like, constantly peace signing it, you know, like coming outside, really walking. And if I'm by myself, like a lot of times I'll cut promos out here because I'm just, my brain's constantly moving and the juices are flowing. But sometimes my brain's completely shut off and I'm just walking around. I don't got to talk to anybody. I don't got to interact with anybody. It just gives me my inner peace of like that time of day, or like sometimes people don't get their alone time, which is so important in mental health. I'm just an advocate of mental health all of a sudden. It makes me release anything going on in my life, and I don't gotta worry about it. I let my beer blow in the wind, legitimately, you know what I mean? Because I can't afford medication because I'm broke half the time. So this is what I do. This is my mental medication, if that makes any kind of sense in the world. I mean, to me, it was just a building that apparently had great pizza. Oddly enough, I think I've had the pizza like twice. And here's my honest opinion on it. It was all right. But obviously, all jokes aside, man, it's crazy. Spalding Hall is where I grew up in front of a lot of people. We've kind of been in and out with my career and like talked about stuff. But like, this is the first building that like my name was attached to. That never happened before. It was kind of weird. Gary J. and Spalding Hall, like, who's the mayor here? Me. You know what I mean? Joking. But, like, at the same time, it's like my name became synonymous with the hall. Which is weird, though, because it's just like a banquet hall. Spalding Hall. It used to be a nice Columbus Hall. And then, as the Anarchy brand grew, and obviously so did I grew in front of everybody because I was constantly pushed. I was put in situations where I was nervous and didn't know if I would sink or swim. And obviously, I stayed afloat. And then I eventually ended up being one of those pillars, as we kind of were talking about in the car, about like, oh, Gary's a pillar of St. Louis wrestling, or Gary's a pillar of St. Louis Anarchy. That doesn't mean like I'm top of the card, I'm a top guy, beep-boop, beep-boop, you know, thanks, Connor. But like, that also means I help backstage a lot. That also means like I'm there to help navigate and help with the younger talent, help them create and get to where they want to be. Like I said, you build the brand and then you build the brand with the building, and it was just like just super awesome relationship. Everybody at this building, with the pizza guys, the bartenders, the whole lady Megan, shouts out to you. Thank you for everything you did for us. And at the end, it was like a match made in heaven that quickly turned into a match made in hell. We knew at the last leg, right before pandemic, that they were selling, or they were gonna be selling, but we still had our dates. They're like, it's gonna be a while, so you can still get your dates in. Like, okay, well, we'll cross that bridge. We knew in the back of our minds that we're gonna have to come up with an A, B, C, D, and an E plan, you know? Like, we knew that. Pandemic hit. Any businesses like this, any bars, a lot of your like local church owned or anything to do with like showing up, having fun, having a drink or eating, ended, because obviously you could get COVID. There were so many like negative things about that. this is a cash business. This building is a, like, they live and die off, like, who shows up to hang out and buys drinks or pizza or food or who rents the hall. If you can't rent this hall, they're not making any money. So then you fast forward and COVID got a little better, and then we could have shows with a restriction of 50 people. Obviously, we got one show in and then got shut right back down. Bummer. Obviously, everybody's like, what do we do now? It's like, and then on top of that, they're like, we're done in December. The hall is done in that December. It's like, well, we're losing our home. Our last show here was August of 2000 and I want to say 19? August 7th, I believe, was our last show in this building. Between then and December and January, even like February, during pandemic, we were in, you know, I'm just going to, you know, say it. We were going to buy this building. The Anarchy management and crew were going to buy this building. I think we've kind of talked about it, but like, I'll just talk about it here. We were going to buy this building and everything was kind of looking pretty good. We shot an offer and they're like, okay. But we were just dealing with a guy that actually takes care of daily business here. He's like, well, let me get a second opinion and some feedback. They want me to ask this broker, like a stock guy. And like, he said, real estate, I think agent is, yeah. We have a meeting, it goes, eh. And eventually they're like, no, we want this. It was way out of our price range. And to be honest, no one was gonna buy this building for that much money. And we tried to explain to him, like, religiously, like, I don't think you understand, like, what we do and, like, what's happened in this building. We tried to explain to them during this meeting and explain to them over and over and over and over again how much this building actually meant to people. And meant to the guys and the wrestlers that, like, grew up here and got better and got their first big taste of, like, a big fight feel or a big match or a big moment. We tried to explain it to him, like, what it meant to people and what we wanted to do with it, which was, like, start wrestling school, clean it up a little bit, rent the hall out. We wanted to help run the bar and, like, you know, create a social media presence for the building. Couldn't call it Spalding Hall, but we didn't know what we were going to call. But, you know, it was all in talks, and it was all like, fuck, this is really getting me charged up and going. They were like, well, we just worry that you guys are going to sell the building, and it's going to become, like, a fucking tire warehouse. It's like, why would we do that? We are actively the only people talking to you about buying this building, you know? So, like, obviously, eventually, we just had to go, all right, we got to wash our hands of it because we can't live in the past forever. So then it's like, well, when the pandemic is a little better or hopefully things clear up, we need to run and we want to run. It's just like, it just can't be here. But now, we've moved forward, and now Elks Lodge, Granite City, we have a new home. We understand it's not Spalding Hall, but it's the Elks Lodge now. Someone said it's like the Madhouse of Anarchy because so many ECW fans, you know? Sure, Madhouse of Anarchy it is. We've made our own atmosphere there. I love the pavilion. It's fucking awesome. The inside months inside are going to be different and unique. It'll be great. Once again, it's not the building that makes what we do. It's the crew from people that set up and tear down, me being one of them, from anybody that helps with anything, concessions, food, videos, or just wants to help out in any aspect because they want to feel part of that atmosphere and brand, to the fans who obviously make it huge, and then everybody involved in ring. Thank you, like 1,000 times over. And I say that anytime you're setting up or tearing down with me, I will look at you and go, thank you, I appreciate it. And I'm not blowing smoke up your ass. I'm not just trying to be like company guy. That means a lot. Because without that, without all the behind the scenes stuff, all the show shit wouldn't happen. You know? If there's no ring for me to wrestle in, how do I wrestle? How do I put on what I like to do? If I'm not there setting up or someone doesn't help set up, or how are we gonna make money in Anarchy with concessions if no one wants to help? It takes a lot of fucking people to build that one thing. And generally, as someone who is in management and someone who is very close with the person that helps run the whole kit caboodle, we are so thankful and grateful for all of that. And we always will be, because we are solely based off the people that made us. We don't have a money backer. We don't have this big bank account to be like, all right, let's just burn money. It is all based of what we produce and the fans that buy the tickets. and everybody that is involved. So once again, a thousand times, I am forever grateful for all of it.
Some things in like sports and entertainment where you're simply synonymous with the things that surround you. Kanye is synonymous with Chicago. It's the Chicago guy. Same with like somebody like Q Keep or Outkast to Atlanta. The way the Outkast is to Atlanta is the way Gary J is to St. Louis wrestling. I can't really put it into words, but it's a special sort of connection that he has with the scene and its fans, to where he will, and he has, given every single inch and piece of his mind, especially his body, and he bears his soul on the canvas every single time to wrestle, specifically in the, everywhere he goes, really, but specifically in that area, because he loves it. Not just wrestling, he loves where he comes from. He loves the city of St. Louis. And I can't think of another wrestler as closely associated with loving their city like he is. Only people who come close is like Eddie Kingston in New York, or someone like Homicide in New York, or I can't really even put it to words, but there's some people who are just completely synonymous with where they come from. There's some people who become who they come from. As much as Gary J is a part of St. Louis, St. Louis is Gary J.
Basically, we go home in January, so like that'll all be revealed on Thanksgiving. So this will be So I'm stoked. And it's crazy because during the main, they start chanting. And I was like, whoa, these people don't know. It's like that Hulk me up, dude. It was a feeling, you know what I mean?
So, like, how'd you guys get
that day? We went up there to hang out and have fun and, like, shoot stuff.
So you guys were filming this outside of the building, and Gary had put a photo online just of him outside there, and it got a lot of online traction. And honestly, like, I didn't really have any desire to go back there. I kind of feel like you have to move on when something like that happens, and the fans love it so much. Like, if you kind of keep dangling that carrot, you can never move on. But it got such a big reaction, I was like, well, let me try to figure out who bought it, like, who owns it.
Ring-a-ding-ding, and contact, and meeting, and bam.
The rules is when I defend this title, it's at home.
Goes by one name, and that's Home. Welcome Home!
At this point, I feel like that building has like special powers or something at this point, you know? And then when you throw Gary J in there, it's just like an anomaly, you know? It's just a very special building is really the best way I could put it.
Our main event here, it looks like Billy has sent out the Blueids.
The Blueids, Jesus. Space Jesus.
Space Jesus and the Blueids.
I would like to say that Gary had like a positive effect on my career. Like, he's very, very fun loving, and you can truly see that he loves wrestling, and I'm truly connected with Gary, and I think we're gonna put on a phenomenal match.
Number one contender, Billy Tista, Space Jesus, Billy!
Cage match. Gary J in singles matches in this building across all promotions. Gary J has a 71.2 winning percentage.
It honestly feels great, like, being back at Spalding. This is truly like Anarchy's home. Like, the vibe, like, when we were at other places, wasn't the same. Like, this is when I first wrestled for Anarchy. He was in this building, and there's no feeling, like, matched to this.
Ah! Ah, ah, ah! Billy's sucking him in and hit him with a bottle!
She got a chair?
Oh. Oh, no stick! Now, there we go, hacking the wound. Ah! Pulling at his face! That is the absolute
over the wound. Mashing it into his eyes.
Biting him. What the hell?
Hell yeah, kid. You're going to go far.
Gary's just a supporter of independent wrestling. He wants to bring it into a better light than what it already is. And he's doing that just by being a phenomenal wrestler. He's taking young kids like me and other people that just love this business and creating something where everybody can enjoy it.
Oh, whips are around.
Nope, she caught him. Half and half! DDT on the floor! Damn, double stomp. Super Frankensteiner! Big kick to the head! Got all of it! No! Oh! Oh, damn it! Knockout blow, and a skull ball, and does it!
Well, we're home, and I guess it's funny, because I do talk a lot with an echo in this bathroom, and, like, I don't know, the one thing that sums up the battle I just had with a great professional wrestler, Billy Starks, at home in Spalding, is genuine. It's not forced. That feeling comes from my bowels, per se, you know? Deep down inside, the emotion that goes in everything we do in this building. It's, I hate using the word magic because it's a cliche, but you know, it's magic. And it's not cliche, it's not a billboard. It's everybody, crew, fans, it's that anarchy atmosphere that, like, man. That, I mean, you know, I'm gonna get really, really graphic. Yeah, get your dick hard, you know? Like, it's insane. And then you got someone, Billy Starks. She's young, blah, blah, this and that. It doesn't matter. And I don't think of her as a she, and that's not a disrespectful thing. She's an athlete, and she's a fucking damn good professional wrestler. That's all that fucking matters when you step into that ring. So, I don't say much, because you gotta earn my respect. And Billy, you fucking earned my respect tonight. So, did you ever watch this when you're cashing checks bigger than I've ever seen in my life before? Thank you.
Gary J is synonymous with St. Louis Anarchy. That's the first place and the place that gave me the ball and I ran with it. Obviously now, as a brand of my own and like my own being, I go and do that everywhere. But St. Louis Anarchy is always home. When I'm out of the wrestling business when it comes to like in-ring, I will be backstage hanging out with Matt, helping run around like a maniac like he does the day shows. Because that's what I want. I want to help cultivate talent. I want to help get people where they want to go. And like that's kind of like a nice little bow on top of like this whole documentary of like the effect it's had on me, my relationships, my life, the good, the bad, the ugly, the ups, the downs. You know, it's like Gary Neller was just a kid when he walked into this building, because I was going through a lot in the early like 2012, 13. Don't quote me on it. But now doing this in 2021, people have seen me grow up. They know I've been through the ringer in this building physically and mentally. I've been exhausted. I've cried in this building. Just a pure emotion of what I was feeling after a certain situation. I've cried. And like, obviously, tough guys don't cry. Fuck yeah, they do. Like, when you can build that much energy and that much rapport with an audience, of course you're gonna give them everything you have. Here, physically. It's just insane. Like, it's the vibes. It's that energy. And, like I said, it's a nice little bow on top of everything now. It's one of those things where, like, Gary Neller walks in this building years and years and years and years ago as a person. Gary Neller's standing here right now, not as Gary J or the performer or the goof or the guy that makes people laugh or people think he's an asshole. But Gary Neller, the human being, standing here right now saying, this building saved my life. St. Louis Anarchy and professional wrestling saved my life. I think that's a little, yeah.
Walking past the mirror thread in my eyes, I stumble in my broken glass.